this day. Thank you, God, for your Son, Jesus Christ, in Calvary, Lord, and what it has meant to our lives, what it has meant for those in the past, Father. And we just love being in your house today. We want to glorify your name in a mighty way, Father, through music, through our prayers, through our worship, and definitely through the message that you've laid upon Pastor Pat's heart today that he will be given to us, Lord. We just ask that if anybody is in attendance today that does not know your Son, Jesus Christ, that today will be the day that they see the light and that they come to your altar and ask for Jesus to be in their hearts, Lord, and have faith in what he did on Calvary and his resurrection. We ask that you be with everything said and done in this sanctuary today, that it would be pleasing to you, Lord, and forgive us of our sins and our lives, Father, in your loving Son, Christ Jesus, holy above all names. Amen.
Amen. Well, good morning, church, on this fourth Sunday of Advent. We're going to ask if Brandon and Caroline would come on up with that precious little package they have, Waylon. And we thought we would start off this service today by dedicating him and dedicating his parents. In fact, in my mind's eye, it's more, come on, just come on right up here. More, in my mind's eye, it's more dedicating them. As a Southern Baptist, as a Baptist church, we don't believe in infant baptism. We don't believe in that infants can make a change. But what we do believe is that we should dedicate these children in the same way that Samuel was brought by his mother to be dedicated. And so that's what we're going to do today. We are going to dedicate the parents and going to dedicate him to the Lord as we come. And this is a time of thinking about children. Christmas is a time we think about children because we think about the birth of Jesus Christ. Well, what they brighten up our home, don't they? Amen. They have their moments, but they sure brighten up our home. There can be things going on helter-skelter in a room and let a baby come in. And people just turn their attention and begin to think about those kinds of things. Now, Brandon and Caroline have the responsibility to raise him physically, to provide for his needs, to provide protection, physical protection for him, and to ensure that he gets the things that he needs to grow up. But more importantly, they have a responsibility spiritually to this young child, to raise this child up in the knowledge of Jesus Christ. Now, they can't save him, even though they would love to. They can't. And until Waylon reaches the age of accountability, he is covered by the grace of God. But once he reaches that age of accountability, then it is on him to take and decide what he's going to do with Jesus Christ as his Lord and as his Savior, and what he's going to do with his mortal soul. And so recognizing this responsibility that you have, and church, we have a responsibility also to the parents to help them and to pray for them and be there for them in the raising of this child, especially when you have a family who grows up in a church and stays in a church, and you have a responsibility to that. And so recognizing this responsibility, we are going to dedicate him, Waylon Parker, and we're going to dedicate his parents as we bring them before the church today. Genesis, the 18th chapter, verses 17 through 19 says this, "And the Lord said, I know Abraham, that he will command his children and his household after him. I will command him because I know he's going to take and he's going to fulfill his responsibilities. And they shall keep the way of the Lord and do justice and judgment." In 1 Samuel, the first chapter says, "Hannah bare a son and called his name Samuel. And she brought his and she brought him to the and his to the to, excuse me, and she brought him into the house of the Lord of Shiloh. to Eli, and she said, "For this child I prayed, and the Lord hath given me my petition which I ask of him. Therefore also I have lent him to the Lord as long as he lives." And Samuel grew, and the Lord was with him, and did not let none of his words fall to the ground. And then in Proverbs, that famous passage that we use and we pray for, "Train up a child in which the way that they go, and when they are old, they will not depart from it." They may move to one side or the other, but they will not depart from it. Caroline, you and Brandon have brought this child, Waylon, before God primarily, and to this church today, to dedicate him and to the Lord, and to give him to the Lord, and to show your responsibilities and how that you take it serious as parents on this day. And so I have a couple questions to ask. Chosen by God, you were chosen by God to be Waylon's parents. It is not haphazard. God chose you too to be his parents. Having been chosen, do you promise before God and this church that you will endeavor to bring Waylon up in the nature of the Lord? You will instruct him in the teachings of the Bible and of the church. You will support the church, thus teaching Waylon reverence for God and for the church. Will you instruct him in the ways of God and teach him to pray and to seek to lead him into the love of God and his service? If you do, say, "We do." Church, you have a responsibility in this process also. You are his spiritual family. You will have the joy of watching this little boy grow up in this church, watching him run down through the pews, and watching him throw a book or a Bible, or watching him do things that kids do on occasion, and to hear him every once in a while yell out his dissatisfaction with something that's going on. But you know, I'd rather have him here doing that than not have him here. But you have a responsibility. So church, do you promise to pray for Brandon and Caroline? Do you promise to help them carry out their obligation and their solemn responsibility to raise Waylon in the ways of the Lord, to both God and in matters that he needs to understand and God will lead him? Do you accept your responsibility to assist in the nature and in the growth of this family and of this little boy? If you do, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. Lynn grabs my beard all the time, so I'm used to it. How precious these little children are. You remember Jesus says, "Do not hinder the children to come to me." He loved little children. And I like to hold children when I pray for them. I'm going to pray for him, and I'm going to take and pray for you two also, but especially for him, and ask that God's blessings be upon him. Would you take and bow with me as we pray? Father, Brandon and Caroline have, in front of you and this congregation, made a covenant. They have made a commitment to raise Waylon in the ways of the Lord. They have made a covenant, Father, to teach him about your word and to teach him about Jesus, to teach him about prayer. They have made a covenant, Father, to raise him up in the church and to have a love for the church. And Father, I just pray that you'll strengthen them. There'll be days that is tough. There'll be days that they will wonder. But Father, you are there for the strength that they need. Father, we pray for this child, this precious child that you have given to them. Father, when he reaches that age of accountability, we pray that you'll take and work in his heart, and the Holy Spirit will work in his heart. And because of the teachings of his mom and dad, because of the teachings of this church, he will come to know you as his Savior and his Lord. Father, continue to touch this church and bless this church. Continue to take and to watch over this church as they help Brandon and Caroline to raise Waylon. and to take and do the things you have called them to do for this little boy. Father, it is our honor and our privilege to lift this child up to you now in dedication and pray that you'll give him a long life, that you'll give him opportunities to serve you and to serve others, and that he'll grow up with a love in his heart for you, for Jesus, and for other people in this church and in this community. So Heavenly Father, thank you for this child. Thank you for the dedication of this family. And I pray that you'll just continue to strengthen, love, and be with them now. For it's in your holy and blessed and precious name we pray. And everybody said, amen and amen. All right, sweetie, let me give you back to mom. I heard him hitting that mic. I was afraid he was going to pull it off. But that's okay. We have a dedication certificate here that I know will go in a prominent place. And it says, we, Brandon and Caroline Parker, commit ourselves to the Christian nurture of Waylon Bean Parker, entering into this commitment at Faymont Baptist Church as a part of the of congregational worship on December the 19th, 2021. After the end of the service, you all will sign it, and I'll sign it also, so we'll get that taken care of. Also, we have a little New Testament here for him with Psalms. And I would ask if you'd let me have that. I'd like to write something in the front of it for you. Okay. All right. Let's give them a big hand. When you join us. And now we'll have the lighting of our fourth Advent candle.
Hard to follow that up, but I guess we followed up with Jesus, we're doing all right, right? From Matthew 2, 1 through 2, and 9 through 11, we hear these words. After Jesus was born in Bethlehem in Judea, during the time of King Herod, Magi from the east came to Jerusalem and asked, "Where is the one who has been born King of the Jews? We saw his star in the east and have come to worship him." After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen in the east went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was born. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the manger, they saw the child with his mother, Mary, and they bowed down and worshipped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented him with the gifts of gold and of incense and of myrrh. Today, in the fourth Sunday of Advent, the wise men traveled from afar to see not just an earthly king, they traveled to worship the heavenly king. Jesus' kingdom is not of this world. This is the truth that the wise men recognized. Upon their visit to the child Jesus, they knew the truth that though he was an infant now, he would share his father's throne. Jesus may have come as a child, but a time will come when every knee shall bow and worship him as Christ the Lord. All people of all time will recognize him for who he is, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. A Savior has come to bring glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among all people. May the spirit of peace and wonderment pervade our midst as we anticipate the coming of Christmas Day. The candle of love is lit. Christmas is coming.
Let us pray. Lord Jesus, you are the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Help us to proclaim, like the wise men, that you are the King of our lives and bring you the gift of our life today. To you be all the glory, all the praise, and all the worship as we gather in anticipation of your coming. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen. As we enter into a spirit of worship, please stand up, sit down. Doesn't really matter what position you're in as long as your heart is ready to worship. So here we go.
And if you still have your tithes, go ahead and bring them forward. You can put them into the plates while we sing. Thank you.
Thank you. to believe why your joyous strains prolong. What the glad song's tidings bring, which inspire your heavenly song. Gloria, in excelsis Deo.
Compassing King to all him.
The King.
King of kings salvation brings. Let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste to bring him now, the faith, the Son of Mary. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing.
God, a clap praise today. Yes. You know, this next song is a song that starts out as despair. This man, Henry Wadsworth Longfellow, has not only lost his son in the Civil War, but he loses his wife from the effects of their house burning down and her being overcome by those. This is the spirit of what God does for us inside if we allow him to. So this is why I've sung this song for as many years as I can, because it's a song of hope. It's a song of Christmas and what Christmas should mean to us all. On Christmas Day, their old familiar carols play, and mild and sweet their songs repeat of peace on earth, goodwill to men. And the bells are ringing. Choir they're singing, and in my heart I hear them, peace on earth, goodwill to men. And in despair I bowed my head. On earth I see, for hate is strong and marks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. But the bells are ringing like a choir singing. A chime, a chant sublime, a peace on earth, goodwill to men. And the bells that ring,
On a dead end road, with a candle flicker in one hand and Dad's hand in the other. Take me back to silent night. My heart was full and the world was right. 'Cause right now the world looks nothing like those innocent Decembers. These days peace on earth is hard to find, and I need you to remind me one more time. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. The snowflakes falling down like a blanket on this town. For a moment we can hardly see the pain this year has brought us. May the sick find healing's touch. May hatred's fight be won with love. And may every heart make room for you, the one who came to save us. 'Cause you're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. My head to pray tonight, felt my little girl by my side. She slipped her tiny hand in mine, and we both talked to you. And it took me back to 8 years old, my daddy's hand and a story told about heaven's love in a manger low, and a promise that's still true. You're still the hope of Christmas. You're still the light when the world looks dark. You're still the hope of Christmas. And you're still the hope of my heart. Still the hope of my heart.
Thank you, girls, as you're leaving. What a great message for us to be reminded of on this Christmas, on this Sunday before Christmas, is that Jesus is the hope of the world. And I'm so glad he is, aren't you? That Jesus is the hope of this world. If it was dependent on me or you or someone else, we would surely let the world down. But Jesus Christ has never let the world down. That doesn't mean he's always done what the world wanted him to do, but he's never let the world down. And I'm so thrilled about that. Thank you so much this morning, girls, for doing that. Thank you so much, Brandon and Caroline, for letting us dedicate that sweet baby of yours. Thank you, Tony, for leading us through, and praise team, thank you so much for reminding us of the wonderful music of Christmas time as we have joined together. Turn your Bibles today, if you would, me, if you would with me to Luke, the second chapter, verses 8 through 20. Luke, the second chapter, verses 8 through 20. I'm going to look at most of the verses, so I'm not going to read them all as we get ready to get started, understanding that we need to get on into the scripture. It has been a wonderful service so far. Thank you, God, for blessing us with that. But in Luke, the second chapter, verses 8 through 20, what we're going to look at today is we're going to look at what I call Christmas joy, the joy that the shepherds had when the angels came and told them about the birth of Jesus Christ. Can you imagine the shepherds received the greatest news that had ever been told on this earth? That a Savior was born in Bethlehem? Can you imagine the gift that they were enabled to receive on that night as they went to check on that baby and to see? I find it interesting that God would choose dirty, nasty, and if you're airborne, I know you think I'm going to say leg, I'm not going to say that, or dirty, nasty shepherds in order to get his, and listen what it says in 2:8. It doesn't tell us about much who they are. It doesn't give us a lot of adjectives to describe who they are, but what it does say is that there were shepherds that were staying out in the fields, watching their flocks, doing their job, in a very mundane, ordinary job, and all of a sudden an angel appears. Can you imagine the fear that they had? We've already seen that in Joseph, and we've already seen that in Mary. And notice that the angel said to both of them, and the angel said to them, do not be afraid. Listen to me. During this Christmas season, we need to be reminded. The angel says to us, do not be afraid, for I am with you always, even unto the end of the earth. And the shepherds are sitting there, doing ordinary, mundane, settled in for the night. And the angel says to them the great announcement that they have been chosen to receive the only time that God verbally tells anyone that his son is going to be born. These shepherds who are low on the totem pole, today is born a Savior. Now, throughout history, some of the mightier names we know in the Old Testament were shepherds. You think of David, you think of Abraham, you think of others. But by the time that we come to the first century, shepherds were not viewed in the light that they once were. They had sort of lost their luster. They were seen as the lowest of the low. They were seen as those that couldn't be trusted. In the Talmud, which is a collection of sayings by the Jewish leaders of their day and time with interpretations and insight, here's what they said: do not help foreigners, heathen, or shepherds. In order to understand how unusual it was to have God come to these men who were out there on the side, we need to be reminded that God uses and loves every single one. Now, let me tell you something as we pause here for just a moment. God loves you. God cares about you. God knows your history better than anybody else. God knows your warts and all better than anybody else. God knows the number of hair that you have on your head. He knows the thoughts that have gone between your ears. He knows the things you have said that you're not proud of and you don't want anybody else to, and God yet still loves you. Does not matter what your job is, does not matter what you do, does not matter what side of the tracks you were raised on, doesn't matter what color your skin is, doesn't matter what you are thinking about and doing about the rest of the afternoon, God loves you and cares about you very much. Think about it. Here were men that were ceremonially unclean. They could not go into the temple or the synagogue because they didn't have time because of their job to clean themselves up to go. Here were men who were mostly isolated and forgotten. Did somebody get up in the morning and the shepherds were friends with one another, but and maybe their families remembered them, but nobody else remembered who they were and what that they were doing. They were treated with contempt. They were treated with mistrust. They were not allowed to testify in a court. They were not allowed, they were known as brash. They were known as bold. They were known to say, what is yours is mine. They were known to have sticky fingers at times. But you see, God entrusted the greatest message that he'd ever given from heaven to a smelly bunch of shepherds. And I don't think that's unusual. If you look into the Bible, God doesn't always do things the way we want him to, does he? He doesn't do the things the way we think he's going to do, does he? God has always worked wonders for the forgotten. God has always worked wonders for the despised. God has always worked wonder for the lonely. From the very beginning of time, Jesus came to those who felt horrible, to those who didn't think anybody cared about them, to the outcasts of what was going on. Jesus came to them. Listen to what Matthew, the 9th chapter, verses 12 through 13 said. It is not those who are well who need a doctor. But who needs the doctor? The sick. Go and learn what this means. I desire mercy, not sacrifice. For I didn't come to call the righteous, but I came to call sinners. And brothers and sisters, that's you and me. God has called you and me. We are sinners. Think about it. Jesus reached out to sinners like Zacchaeus, like Levi, who became Matthew. Jesus reached out to prostitutes. Jesus reached out to people who were demon-possessed. He reached out to strangers. He reached out to Samaritans who were half-Jews. He did in his ministry what the Father did for you and me when Jesus was born on that night in a manger, oh, well over 2,000 years ago. Mary captured this when she had her song in Luke 1:52 that says, he has toppled the mighty from their thrones and exalted the lowly. Paul says in 1 Corinthians 1:26 through 29, hear what he says, brothers and sisters, consider your calling. Not many were wise from a human perspective. Not many were powerful. Not many of noble birth. Instead, God, now listen, hear this, God has chose the foolishness in the world to shame the wise. God has chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. God has chosen what is insignificant and despised in the world, what is viewed as nothing, to bring to nothing what is viewed as something, so that no one may boast in his presence. It does not say The Bible does not say that there were scribes in the same region sitting down with their scrolls and getting ready to hear the announcement that came from God about Jesus Christ. The Lord came to the lowly. Jesus came to the most undeserving and the neglected and the marginalized to show his power. And the shepherds help us to see that God has a message for every single sinner. Why? Because every single person matters to God. And only the announcement of Christ's birth goes out to a bunch of uneducated outcasts. And indeed, as the song says, what a strong way to save the world. As we briefly look at these shepherds' response, there are several things I want you to understand why they had joy. You see, the shepherds responded in a certain way, and that is what fulfilled the joy that they had in knowing, seeing, going to the birth of Jesus Christ. And so we need to have that joy as we are in this season and follow what they did. What's the very first thing they did? The very first thing they did, we see, is that they were attentive to their jobs. Listen to what it says in Luke 2:8. In the same region, shepherds were staying out in the field, and what were they doing? Doing their job. They were keeping watch at the night over their flocks. They were committed to their career, and their career was 24/7. They didn't work third shift and go home. They worked first shift, second shift, third shift. They worked all the time. It was a 24/7 deal for them. And you see from this verse that they were faithful to what they had been called to do. Now, let me tell you something, brothers and sisters. God wants you and I to be faithful if we're going to enjoy, if we're going to have the joy of Christmas in our lives during this season. When God wants us to be faithful, that doesn't mean we are faithful one day a week or 2 days a week or three or four or five or six. It means that we are faithful to Him 7 days a week. It means we are prepared and we are ready to go and do what God has led us, what God has called to us, and what God would have us to do. You see, notice that God came to those who were attentive to what they were doing. These men were not slackers. They didn't sit back on the seat of do-nothing and say, I'm not going to do anything. I'm going to let the 20% who are in the church do 90% of the work, and I'll help here and there, and I'll help there and do certain things. No, God intends for us to be attentive. God intends for us to be effective. God intends for us to do what He would have us to do. Whatever God has called us to do, listen to what it says in Colossians 3:23. Whatever you do, preacher, deacon, Sunday school teacher, clean the pews, make sure that things are taken care of, lock up the doors, make sure that things are going the way they should. Those that we've already seen back up there doing the AV stuff for us and do a great job. Whatever you do, do it from the heart as something done for the Lord and not for people. You see, we may be thinking that God doesn't even know we exist. I've had people tell me there are over 7 billion people in this world. How can God know that I exist? 7 billion people. I can't even hardly remember my family's names. And I say to them, listen, that is the power and the knowledge and more importantly, the love of God, that God knows every single person who has ever been born, who is alive now, and if Jesus tarries the second coming, we'll be born. God knows every single one. And God's not mad at us. God, the Emmanuel, as we call Him during this time, we are not insignificant to God. Now, some people are more visible by what they do, but God cares about every single one of you. Look around this room, and every single one of you, from that little baby Waylon to the oldest one who's here this morning, and all of you in between, you are significant to God. The shepherds were significant to God. And God, in His wisdom, showed these people that the world says was insignificant to give them the message that Jesus Christ was going to be born. You see, God chooses a message to the messed up. God takes and works with those who sometimes wonder that no one cares and no one knows. And yet God's got a plan, and all we've got to do is be attentive to what God calls us to do. And if we want to experience joy during this Christmas season, we have got to be attentive to what God would have us do as we go through this. Notice the second thing they do. They were in awe. Now, they were afraid, but they were in awe. Listen to what verse number 9 says. And then the angel, these shepherds are doing their job. They're just sort of settled down for the evening, and all of a sudden a light comes out into the sky. And it says, then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone about them, and they were terrified. Listen to me. God meets us exactly where we are. God meets us exactly where our needs are. God meets us exactly where we think got things going on in our life, and God knows exactly what that we need. And notice what God did. God's glory. It says that God's glory. God didn't take a candle like we did this morning and take a match and light it. God doesn't have to do that. God is light. God is glory. And anytime God is there, can you imagine? It's nighttime. The shepherds are sitting there. It's sort of dark. Maybe they're looking at stars that they've seen every night for years and years and years. And all of a sudden, it lights up. You see, when God comes into your life, there ought to be an awe in your life, because the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is working in your life, and He will bring light to any situation that you are in, to anything that you are dealing with, cancer, sickness, relationships that aren't going the way they should, death, whatever it is. God can bring light into the situation, and God can help you to see His way for you no matter what it is that you are doing. Listen to Luke, the 5th chapter. Jesus, when Peter said to Him, look, Lord, I am not worthy. Get away from me, Lord. And He says, nope, I cannot get away from you, Peter. You are one of my disciples, and I'm going to lead you and guide you and direct you. I've not come to judge you. I've not come to take and to point fingers at you, because let me tell you what, if anybody could have had Jesus look at them and point His finger, it was Peter. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, 3 times Peter said, I do not know Him. And on the 3rd time, he even cussed at the girl who said, don't you know, you're the one of His. And that's why in John, the 21st chapter, Jesus goes and finds Peter fishing. And 3 times He says, Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know I do. Then feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me? Lord, you know I do. Then feed my sheep. And on the 3rd time, it grieved the heart of Peter. But then Peter understood exactly. He had denied Jesus 3 times. And so Jesus wanted him to understand that, Peter, I will forgive you no matter how long it takes. Because if you love me, you are going to fail. If you love me, you are going to take and fall. If you love me, there are going to be times that you're going to sin. You are not perfect, Peter, and you will not be perfect until you receive that new body that I'm going to give you when you get into glory. But until that time, Peter, love me and feed my sheep. There was an awe that Peter had because of what Jesus did to him. There was an awe that the shepherds had, because here they were that night where they thought nobody knew where they were except the sheep that they were taking care of. And all of a sudden it said that when the angel said that message, that it said that the heavens was full of angels, and they began to sing about the glory of God and what God was going to take and do for them. Now, the 3rd thing they did is they accepted the message. There are people who will sit in church for years and hear biblical preaching, will hear and feel the Spirit pulling at their heart and letting them know that they need Jesus Christ, and they will sit there. Brothers and sisters, it is one thing to know the message. It is another thing to accept the message and live it out in your heart. Notice what they said in verse number 10. But the angel of the Lord said to them, don't be afraid, for look, I proclaim to you. And what did He proclaim to them? The good news of great joy that will be for all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior. The angel is calming them down. Let me tell you what, God can calm you down better than anything else if you let Him. God can calm you down no matter what's going on in your life if you let Him. But you've got to accept the message. When I was at one of my church, my second church, we had a man in that church. His name was Lakin Willoughby, 83 years old when I got there. His daughter talked to me within a week of beginning to pastor that church, and he said, here is my one prayer. My dad is 83 years old. He has sat in this church for years and never made a commitment to Jesus Christ. I want him to know Jesus more than anything else. I have been praying for him for years, and my goal is that he knows Jesus Christ. And I went and talked to Lakin Willoughby, and in talking, now it didn't happen overnight, but in talking to him over several times and different times, I finally asked him one day, I said, Lakin, I've got a dollar bill right here in my hand. Do you see this dollar bill? He said, yes. Would you like to have this dollar bill? Now, this was back in the 80s when a dollar bought more than it does today. I'd like to have that dollar bill. I said, Lakin, what do you have to do to receive this dollar bill? He said, preacher, I've got to accept it. I can look at it all day long. I can know that it's 100 pennies, it's 10 dimes, it's 20 nickels, it's 100 pennies. It's 100 pennies. I can know that. It's four quarters. I can know that. But until I receive it, it's not mine. Lakin, that's what it is with accepting Jesus Christ. You can sit in church all you want to and break hell wide open. Lakin, you can take and say that you know the songs and sing the songs and you've heard the preaching that's been done by several pastors who have been here and you've not done anything about it. They have held the dollar of the scripture, the gospel of Jesus Christ up to you, and you have looked at it, you have looked around it, but you have not accepted that into your heart, and until you accept that, your name will not be written on a Lamb's Book of Life. Preacher, I need to think about that, and I left. Seen him several more times, but about a month later, he called and said, preacher, come and see me. I'm ready to accept the dollar bill. You see, it's one thing to know. It's another thing to accept and to have Jesus come in. Joy is not found in gift giving. Now, it's nice and wonderful. But I have found, and many of you all are my age or older, I have found, Lynn says, what do you want? And I said, I have everything I need. And what I've found as I've gotten older, and I'm sure you're doing the same thing, is that the older I get, I don't need material things anymore. I've got every single thing I want. My son asked me the other day, he works for the Department of Transportation. I love wearing baseball hats. I got one in the car. I'll probably put it on when I get ready to leave. I don't wear it into church, but I got one. And he said, Dad, what do you need? And I said, if you can get me a North Carolina Department of Transportation baseball hat, that's all I want. I like hats. One day, one season, I said, hey, I want a hoodie sweatshirt from where all of y'all went to college. And that's what I got. And I wear them. But you see, the older I get, I understand it's not so much about things. It's people. It's people and Jesus Christ in my life. But I have to accept that. I have to understand that. I have to know that the message is for all people. I have to understand that Jesus came for me and for you and for all of us. And we need to understand verse number 15 says, it says, look, glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to men to whom favor rests. We know we've been accepted when Jesus comes into our heart and we ask him to come in. Listen to what verse 15 said. Let's go to Bethlehem. You see, they not only accepted the message, they did something about it. They got up and they went. Listen to 1 Thessalonians 2:13. Also, this is why we constantly thank God. Because when we have received the message from God about what we have heard, we welcome it not as a human message, but as it truly is, the message of God, which also works effectively in and helps us to become believers. We've got to accept the message that he has for us. And then fourthly, they acted. You see, they not only were in awe, they not only were doing their business, but when the angel came to them, they accepted what the angel gave to them, and then they did something about it. Listen to what verse number 16 said. They hurried off. Now, hurried off means They didn't sit there and have a budget committee meeting. Now listen, please don't hear me to say this wrong. Committees are important to the church, but sometimes committees can slow the church down. Now I know you got to get people together, you got to do things, I got that. But these people didn't say, well, let's have a committee and let's decide if we're going to go see this baby. You see, sometimes when God calls, we have to answer. Do you know that's exactly what Dan did? I saw the traffic that was going on. He said, God has laid upon my heart to go to Kentucky. He's laid upon my heart not to wait till the first of the year, but he's laid on my heart to go now. And so I got to get things together, and I believe he's leaving on Tuesday. He's going because God called him to, and there was a need there. These men did not say, well, let's sit down and vote about it. Let's sit down. Are we going to go? Well, who's going to watch the sheep? You know, I always wondered that question. Who's watching the sheep while they're gone? I think God is. I think God's got an angel right there protecting those sheep, because it said the shepherds got up and they went and they found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in a manger. Come on, let's go. Let's go see this thing. Let's go see what we've been told about. Let's not wait till next week. Let's go see it now. In James 2:17, it says, in the same way, faith, if it doesn't have works, is dead by itself. So you see, they're sitting there, not doing much. They got an awe about it. They accept the message. They go, and then lastly, the Bible says that they left and they shared. You see, brothers and sisters, when we accept Christ into our lives and we want full joy as a believer, then we need to share the message of the gospel. Many times that's just saying, Merry Christmas. You know, there are many stores today that they don't want people to say Merry Christmas anymore. One of the things that's one of my pet peeves is when somebody writes me a card and goes, Xmas. Now, I've never researched it to see why that's on there, but to me, you take the name of Christ out of something and you're taking him out of more than you need to. But we need to take and share the message. It's striking. They did not pull up a bale of hay and say, let's sit here for a while and enjoy this moment. Now, many people would have done that. Wow, here's that baby we've been told about. Wow, here's the Savior. Let's sit here for a while and do that. But the Bible says they didn't hang around because they knew now they were messengers for Jesus Christ and they needed to get the message out there. They needed to let them know. Verse 17, after seeing them, they reported the message. They talked about the message. They shared the message with those they came in contact with. Now let me ask you this as we come to a close soon. In what area is God calling you to have more joy in your life? In what area is God calling you for more action in your life? It is not enough to say that you have faith and then sit there on the seat of do nothing, or that you feel good about something. I'm telling you, this praise team here does a great job and they can make you feel good and it's wonderful, but you really can't enjoy and have the joy that you have unless you know Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, and then it is really good. Is there something that you need to share with others? Or do you want to take the role of the shepherds? Or you want to plant yourself like a tree and be as unmovable as a rock? You see, the shepherds were changed forever. What was it that caused the shepherds, who were a low of the low class in Israel, to take and to come out of that manger and to share the gospel like it had never been shared before? They had accepted, received, and we're leaving to tell people about Jesus Christ. You see, we need to be attentive to what God's called us to do if we're to have joy. We need to be awed by God's message if we're going to have Christmas joy. We need to accept the gift of the good news if we're going to have true joy. We need to take an act upon what we know to be true and share it with other people. Because let me tell you what, Jesus, God has the truth, and the truth will, as the Bible says, set us free. And it will set other people free. And it will help other people to have Christmas joy. You see, the gift must be received, but the shepherds had to personalize it in their response to Jesus Christ. Jesus was born to the whole world, but also, listen to me, he was born for you, and you, and you, and you, and all of us here. Jesus was born for me and for you. And 33 years later, he's going to die for me and for you. Listen to verse number 11 again. Today. Now that means right now. In the city of David, a Savior. Who was the Savior? The only one that can forgive your sins and save you. Was born for you. It was personal. This is not, well, that person down the road is who Jesus died for, and that person over there, or that person in the back. No, Jesus was born for every single person. Who is the Messiah? The long-awaited Messiah who had been told by the Old Testament was coming. And he is the Lord, which means when you accept him, he is the Master and the Lord and the Savior of your life. Is he Savior to you this morning? Is he Christ to you this morning? Is he Lord to you this morning? Let me close with this quote. Many of y'all have heard and know about Corrie Ten Boom. Here's what she had to say about this. If Jesus was born 1,000 times in Bethlehem, but not one time in me, then I would still be lost. It's time today to make sure that you know what that Christmas joy is about, by ensuring that Jesus is your Savior. Amen? Thank you, Lord, so much for reminding us. Wow, what a dynamic story this is. The shepherds were told, they got up and went, they saw the birth, they saw the baby, and then they went out and told other people about it. Father, that's what we need to be about during this Christmas season. This baby who became a man and died on a cross is the only hope for a hopeless world. And Christmas, when people are thinking about this kind of stuff, is a great time to share that hope. If someone's here and they don't know Jesus as their Lord and Savior this morning, I pray, Father, on this fourth Sunday of Advent, this Sunday before Christmas that we're going to share together, Father, this Sunday that you're speaking to them, and something from this story has touched their heart. I pray, Heavenly Father, today's the day. But I also pray, Heavenly Father, that maybe someone here who has not experienced that joy in a while, maybe there's someone who's here who's not experienced the walk with Jesus as they once did. I don't know, Father, but we're just going to put it in the hands of the Spirit as the Spirit works with people. And as the music goes, and ask that people just come. The altar's open. Deacons are here. We'll talk with you. Don't leave this place without knowing and having the joy of Christmas, Jesus Christ. For it's in your name we pray. And all God's children said, amen. Let's stand together. The music's going to play. I'm here. The deacons are here. If you need to come, we ask that you come as we sing this song or as we play this song. Maybe something the children did touched you. Maybe something that the child dedication touched you. I don't know. Just come as God leads you to come to this altar and give it to him. Thank you. much for being here today. Wow, what a service. Because you're here. But more importantly, because the Holy Spirit's here. The singing was wonderful, as it always is. What a child baby dedication. I mean, that just brings joy to your heart. Those girls up there, they didn't say a word themselves, but wow, what a message they gave to us about Christmas. And thank you, girls. I think many of them, well, there's several, but many went out. Thank you so much. But you know what made it special is Jesus is here, but you're here. You are special and unique, and God loves you, always has, always will. Don't forget Friday night, Christmas Eve. We'll be here about an hour. I'll get you out by 6, but we'll be here an hour, and we're going to look at Jesus. I mean, you say, well, preacher, every time you preach, we look at Jesus. Yeah, we do, but we'll look at Jesus in the content of that what happened the night that he was born and what that love means for us. Tony's got something he wants to share with you about Wednesday night for just a moment.
Check. There we are. I just wanted to share with everybody, Wednesday night service is still going to be going on. Bud McClellan started the first of 6 sessions last week with Tony Evans, and it is a wonderful message. You do not have to be at every single one of them. You can miss one, or you can be at one. They're all individual classes and what he's talking about, so it's something to receive. That probably would help a lot of people out. I know it. Even the first class has helped me out, and everybody knows Bud always preaches a good sermon. There ain't no doubt about that because he's outstanding. Amen?
Amen.
All right, so y'all guys come out Wednesday night. I also wanted to share something with you real quick, too. I shared it with my Sunday school class. I feel that I've let God down by something that he asked me to do back a few years ago. Chris had sent a letter for me to help me out at the Carolina College of Biblical Studies. I'm starting my VRE application paperwork on the 28th. Please pray for me. I'm going to need it for the things that I need to say and do to go and study the seminary at Carolina College of Biblical Studies, and I appreciate and covet all y'all's prayers. Thank you so much.
Amen. Thank you so much, and we'll be much in prayer about for that. If for some reason you can't be here on Friday night, Merry Christmas. And we will see you next Sunday as we're going to look at a new leaf. And what does that mean as we get ready to go into 2022? All minds are clear. Father, bless us as we leave this place. Thank you for what we have felt this morning, but more importantly, thank you for speaking to us through the praise team, through the child dedication, through the girls, and through the message of the story of the shepherds. Wow. So, Father, be with us now as we leave this place. And may we always, as we leave this place, worship you even out there in truth and in glory. For it's in your blessed, precious, and holy name we pray. And everybody said, amen. Amen. God bless you and go in peace.